The Melbourne Underground Rail Loop, usually called the City Loop or just the Loop, is an underground railway line encircling the Melbourne Central Business District. The loop opened in stages in the early 1980s with a goal of distributing passengers more evenly around the CBD, thereby relieving pressure on the extremely busy Flinders Street Station. While lots of cities around the world have circular rail systems around the inner city, Melbourne's City Loop is quite an unusual design and operates in a way that can be very confusing for passengers. In this video, I'm going to explain how the loop is physically laid out, why that creates unusual operating patterns, and how that compares to some other systems. The loop is at the centre of Melbourne's large suburban electrified railway system. If you're not familiar with Melbourne, it's important to understand that the loop is not a dedicated subway or metro system, despite the current private operator being misleadingly named Metro. It's part of Victoria's statewide broad-gauge heavy rail railway network. There are five stations located around the Melbourne CBD. Flinders Street and Southern Cross are both large above-ground stations linked by the elevated Flinders Street Viaduct. Flinders Street is the traditional hub of suburban trains, while Southern Cross is the terminal for regional and interstate trains. Then there are three stations on the underground city loop: Flagstaff, Melbourne Central, and Parliament. It's important to clarify that the name City Loop generally only refers to the underground lines running along the northern and eastern sides of the CBD, not the above ground area to the south and west. All Melbourne suburban lines radiate from the CBD and all have access to the City Loop, although not all lines use it on a regular basis. The loop is actually made up of four completely independent tunnels. Each is single track and caters for a group of lines, known as the Northern, Clifton Hill, Burnley, and Caulfield groups. Each underground station consists of two island platforms, one above the other. The upper deck is used by the Clifton Hill group on platform 1 and the Caulfield group on platform 2, with the lower deck catering for the Northern group on 3 and Burnley on 4. The tunnels themselves do not form a complete loop shape. Rather, each tunnel is essentially shaped like a fish hook, with one end of each tunnel pointing inward towards Flinders Street and Southern Cross, while the other end points out towards the suburbs. And yes, there is one small exception to that, which I'll talk about shortly. Because each group shares a single track tunnel, the group as a whole must travel around the loop in the same direction at any given time. However, the tunnels are signalled for bidirectional operation, and traditionally the direction of travel changes halfway through the day, although in recent years this practice has been discontinued for two of the groups. More on that in a minute. This midday direction change is what makes the operation of the loop really unusual. I'm not aware of anything quite like it elsewhere in the world. Most suburban services are timetabled to start or end at Flinders Street, and the original idea was that in the morning, trains would run in via the loop first before arriving at Flinders Street, where they would either terminate or run directly back to the suburbs. In the afternoon, trains would run directly into Flinders Street, or originate there, then run out via the loop on their way to the suburbs. Because the northern loop is the reverse shape of the other three tunnels, it meant that at those times, trains still ran through the loop in both directions. The big flaw in this plan was that at certain times it was impossible to catch a single train directly between certain major stations. For instance, in the morning it was impossible to travel directly from Flinders Street to any of the loop stations, and the opposite problem existed in the evening. Although to be fair, most of the time you could just walk or take a tram. This has been partly solved in recent years, with the Clifton Hill loop being made to run permanently clockwise in 2013, and the Caulfield loop permanently counterclockwise in 2021. These changes were made for two very different reasons. The Clifton Hill loop had been plagued by a terribly designed junction at Jolimont, where the tunnel entrance is located on the northern side of the double track line. This meant that in order to run counterclockwise, up trains had to cross the down line from Flinders Street, creating a real bottleneck. It's kind of mind-blowing that they went with this design, especially as every other loop entrance is fully grade separated. For instance, if you look at this example at North Melbourne, the ramp drops down between the up and down lines, meaning there's never a conflict. In fact, the Northern Loop Tunnel has two entrances at North Melbourne, allowing fully grade separated access from four platforms, and a similar arrangement exists at the Richmond end of the Caulfield Tunnel. So after years of annoyance and with the system getting constantly busier, it was decided to fix the Jolimont problem by sticking with clockwise operation at all times. The situation for the Caulfield loop was different. In 2020, the tunnel was modified to accommodate the new HCMT trains. Being longer than existing trains, the HCMTs have to pull up right at the end of the platform, which means the signals had to be moved slightly further into the tunnel to remain within the driver's line of sight. These modifications were only done to signals in the counterclockwise direction, and now the Caulfield loop always runs that way. It's worth noting that both those tunnels do retain their signals for operation in the other direction, but it only happens for special workings outside normal operating hours. The remaining two groups which still feature the direction change now only do so on weekdays. with the Northern Group and the Burnley Group running clockwise all day on weekends. Even with these changes, it is still only possible to travel directly between the Loop stations and North Melbourne in one direction at any given time, and a direct trip from the Loop out to Richmond is not possible on weekday mornings. So why did they do the whole direction change thing in the first place? Well, the answer most people give for this is that running via the Loop first in the morning and last in the evening helps to deliver commuters more directly to the busier parts of the CBD, or that it spreads people out more evenly. While there are some elements of truth there, there's actually a more practical reason why this style of operation was chosen. Until the early 1990s, a large proportion of Melbourne's suburban trains were stabled in Jolimont Yard and maintained at Jolimont Workshops, both of which are now long gone. In the 1980s, the network was also much more peak-centric, with off-peak patronage being comparatively very low. A lot of trains stabled at Jolimont Yard between the peaks, or were divided with part of the train running to stable. So operationally, it made sense to run in via the Loop, terminate at Flinders Street, then shunt out to stable in the nearby yard, reversing the process in the evening. If it wasn't for Jolimont Yard, I suspect the Loop may have been designed very differently, and might have been a bit more practical today. So how else could you design something like this? At first glance, Sydney has a very similar situation with their city circle. However, it has a much simpler design and the operation is much easier to understand. The city circle was built in stages between the 1920s and the 1950s, which gives it a totally different character to Melbourne's city loop. The city circle is shaped like a partly deflated balloon, with the neck of the balloon pointing south towards Central Station. The circle is a simple double-track arrangement with trains travelling in both directions at all times. Very broadly speaking, trains coming from the west enter the western side of the circle, run around clockwise, then form trains toward the southwest, and vice versa. Even for trains not following that pattern, conflicts are largely avoided due to this awesome flyover just south of Central. The balloon shape means every train passes through Central twice and avoids Melbourne's problems of unidirectional running and routes that are difficult at certain times of day. It also means that if you're coming from the south or west and heading for Central, which is Sydney's main terminal for regional interstate trains, it's always the first stop as you enter the city. Likewise, if you're heading home, you can always find a train running directly out to the suburbs. It's often quite frustrating in Melbourne having to board a train which departs the wrong way and takes you all the way around the loop before your journey home really even begins, something that can add anything up to 10 or 12 minutes to your journey time depending on where you are. Being a simple double-track arrangement, the city circle is also able to share capacity evenly across all lines which use it, unlike in Melbourne, where some of the tunnels are used by more lines than others. For instance, the Northern Loop is very busy, catering for the Upfield, Craigieburn and Sunbury lines, and also Werribee in the past, whereas the Clifton Hill Tunnel only carries the Mernda and Hurstbridge lines. Overall, I think the design of the city circle is way better and less confusing than the city loop. However, that's not to say a design like that would have worked in Melbourne, as Sydney really benefited from the geographic position of Central being not very centrally located, allowing for that balloon shape. So back to Melbourne, and to clarify that thing I said about the tunnels not forming an actual loop shape. There is actually a short connecting tunnel running from the Parliament end of the Clifton Hill Tunnel around to Flinders Street, known as the City Circle. Not to be confused with Sydney's City Circle or Melbourne's other much more well-known City Circle. This allows trains to run in an actual indefinite circle around the city, and in the early days of the loop there was a service which did just that, which I guess was the solution at the time to the no direct route problem. It was discontinued in the early 90s when the much slower and lower capacity City Circle tram began operation. The tunnel is still used today, but fairly infrequently. As far as I can see, there are no publicly timetabled trains that use it anymore. So the shared part of the Clifton Hill Tunnel is actually called the Clifton Hill / City Circle Loop. In this footage here, we're travelling around the curve in the Northern Loop Tunnel approaching Flinders Street, and you'll notice the tunnel changes shape, here. This is because the tunnels were mostly dug using a circular tunnel boring machine, but the shallow bits near the entrances were built using cut and cover, so that's why the tunnels are rectangular when viewed from above ground, but circular when viewed from the stations. The way the City Loop is operated can be very confusing to passengers, and the various public transport agencies have never done a particularly good job of presenting the information clearly. For instance, trains heading into the city, running around the loop and then to Flinders Street are described as via the city loop. However, to the untrained eye, there's no way of knowing that city loop refers specifically to the underground bit. And if you just look at the map, you'd probably assume the loop is, you know, the whole loop-shaped bit in the middle of the city. So it doesn't clearly explain what route the train is taking. With the vast majority of services technically beginning or ending at Flinders Street, there is also no onboard information about where the train will continue after Flinders Street. Despite the fact that most direct trains will immediately form another service that then runs around the loop. This has created a funny sort of ritual where as a direct train arrives at Flinders Street, people peer out the windows or even open the doors to check whether or not the train is continuing in the right direction. Yeah, you can stay on.
Stay on? Yep. Going to Charlotte.
Yeah.
Thanks.
No worries. It's not uncommon for trains to be transposed onto a different group of lines at Flinders Street, which may not be using the loop in the same direction. There has been some effort to clarify these things in recent times, with platform displays like this showing the next trains to take towards the other major stations. However, I reckon that still just looks fairly confusing, and it also completely ignores the existence of Jolimont Station. The midday direction change also creates this confusing timetable layout, where the city stations are listed twice, allowing both clockwise and counterclockwise running to be shown on the same page. Something else that makes the loop a bit unusual is that when it first opened back in the 80s, it didn't operate on Sundays. This really shows how low weekend patronage was at the time. Even after it began operating daily, Flagstaff Station remained closed on weekends, and this remarkably continued up until the start of 2016. The reason this lasted so long was basically because Flagstaff is in the most boring corner of the CBD, and mostly serves the law courts, which only operate during the week. However, Flagstaff is actually the best place to interchange with Tram Route 58, and is also close to the Flagstaff Gardens, the Vic Market, and a bunch of other things, so finally being able to use it every day of the week was a big win. There is one last vestige of this practice. Suburban trains run all night on Friday and Saturday nights, but the late night trains, roughly between 1 and 5 a.m, don't use the city loop, departing only from Flinders Street. Forgetfully rocking up at Melbourne Central at 2 in the morning to find it closed, then having to drunkenly run down Swanston Street to catch your train, is a Melbourne tradition we probably could have done without. Despite all its oddities, the city loop has remained a crucial part of the suburban system into the 21st century, and the stations have aged quite well, remaining reasonably functional and attractive designs. Pressure on the loop is set to be eased slightly in the next couple of years when the Melbourne Metro Tunnel opens, which will carry the Pakenham, Cranbourne and Sunbury lines, freeing up capacity in the Caulfield and Northern loops. If you'd like to see more footage of operations in the City Loop, I've made quite a few videos down there, and also some on Sydney's City Circle, which you can check out in this playlist. I hope you've enjoyed the video, and hopefully you've all learnt something about the operation of Melbourne's wonderful but confusing underground railway.